call me Abraham, if you don't mind. That's my only request, as I reach my dying time. I've known wretchedness that words can't tell. I've seen the darkest hell when I looked into myself. I've done things you can't forgive. I turned from your grace when you tried to give me sight. Now I pray your grace you give. May I pass through the night with an untroubled mind. May you never know what you will find in a concrete prison cell, on the execution line, all the wickedness that ever was is living in your heart, running in your blood. I've done things you can't forgive. I turned from your grace when you tried to give me sight. Now I pray your grace you give. May I pass through the night with an untroubled mind.
I'm in the most legendary town, Ghost. Here's what we're doing today. We're going to double down.
It was once a secret.
That's it. What's up tonight? I didn't know if anybody show up or not. I didn't know if I was going to show up. So what the hell? Glad you're here. What are we going to talk about tonight? You know, a lot of times I throw about five things on the sidebars when I'm looking to just throw something up because I feel like I want to go on and talk about history or talk about whatever.
Brian Roop.
Well, we got Brian Roop. I'm on live, so he's going to have to hold on. But let's talk a little bit more about, you know, the other night when I was on and I pulled that Quantrell video, I was like, you know what? That was a great day. It was a great story. It was entertaining to me. It's tragic. It's got all the different things. And I said, you know, I need to go watch that again. And I was like, you know what? What the hell? I'll just put it on and then I'll watch it, but I can watch it with you guys. So tonight, if you're not into the border wars and you're not into Quantrell, and you know, here's the thing. I got a bunch of buddies back in Independence, Missouri, that one in particular that is probably what I consider to be an expert on all the battles and all the things that went on during that time. And I'm a 20,000 feet guy. I want to know a little bit about everything, but not specifically, you know. I'm not into, you know, each and every war, even though it's cool, or battle, I should say. I want to move on, and I appreciate the people that can, like, that do the studies, that know the locations, that know the men that were there and things like that, which is really cool. But it's really an interesting journey for me to be here in Arizona and to really realize what it was like back from Independence, Missouri, getting to Independence, Missouri from the East Coast or even Europe, and back in those days, what it would have been like, how difficult it would have been. And then the trials and tribulations of the people that lived in the areas that were under siege, you could say. And this is a very interesting part of the history of the United States of America. There's Rock to Crystals. What's up, Rock to Crystals? Howdy. How are you doing tonight? It's good to see you. Glad you're here, and thank you. So, and if you're looking for crystals like that one, which is always on, you can get one of them from Rock to Crystals of Arizona. But put "of Arizona" when you're looking it up, because the other day I tried to get on it, and if I didn't put "of Arizona," it didn't pop up. So if you're looking on their website or looking on their YouTube page, check that out. So I appreciate you guys. Welcome and thank you. And so I wanted to watch this again because it really is a, you could spend your entire life, if you wanted to, studying just that conflict or that siege in American history, and what it meant and what changes it made, and how it shaped probably the next 100 years. You know, when you put up these videos, a lot of controversy and conflict comes within the realm of these videos. And I'm okay with that because, you know, history is history. You can take it personal or you can not. But the reality of it is it happened. You can't change it. You can't deny it. It's what happened. And I guess you can deny it, but that's not the choice that I make. And I think it's important that we, you know, a lot of people want to forget our history, and that's not going to happen as long as I'm around. I will continue to put stuff out, whether it be controversial, whatever, because these subjects a lot of times are so much bigger than what you think the surface thing is. And so, you know, I'm never going to step into a political ring. I don't need to. You know, I float with a thought process that people did what they had to do. It was their time. It was the times they were in. And who knows how I would have acted within that time? Who knows how I would have been if I would have grown up on one side of the fence or the other? No one ever really knows that until they're there. So that's why I decided, you know what? That was a great trip, though. There's nothing cooler than getting in. Now, that day I was down in those bottoms down there, man, I tell you what, the humidity was ridiculous. I mean, it was like get out of the car and just, it was Florida type humidity. But it was really cool being in that area and going to the places and stepping in those footsteps of the men that a lot of made their final horse ride on that day. And definitely a lot of people in Lawrence, Kansas didn't plan on taking that being their last day either, but it definitely was, and it changed history forever. And it changed the entire complexity of the battle at that time. Now, remember a lot of the stuff that went on also. The Midwest was under siege for years before the Civil War. By the time the Civil War got started, these guys had been battling for 10 years. I mean, they were battle hardened people because they were fighting way before there was even a Civil War going on. Their big conflict was the fact that the U.S. government was going to come in and change. And it was a big deal to see if these states were going to become slave states or not slave states. And so that's where the line got drawn on the state of Missouri and the state of Kansas. And so this conflict was unbelievable. You can't think of the amount of times in history that we have turned on each other. You know, we're real good when it comes to other conflicts and other places and banding together against a common foe. But we're not so good when it comes to the figuring out that, you know, brother against brother, as they say. And this was these conflicts divided this nation for years. And we can't deny that it happened, and I would never would, because the reality of it is who we are. We are who we are today because of that exact stuff that went on. So we watched a little bit of the video last night. I don't know how many people watched it, what we started last night, but I didn't want to throw Quantrell at you if you didn't know you were getting Quantrell and or Jesse James. Because these are main players. I mean, there's a bunch of main players. The Quantrells, the Jameses, the Youngers. They were definitely the Bloody Bill Anderson, the little Arch Clements. These were all major players back then at that time. And there were major players on both sides. But one thing about the Bushwhackers, the Jesse James crew, if you want to know which side is which, is that they were pretty flamboyant. That was one thing about these guys that made this whole thing a little different if you were on that side. One thing, if you look at pictures of these guys, they battled like they look like Jimi Hendrix. So when you saw these guys, they had these sashes, they had these shirts that were embroidered with flowers and things on them. They had this cavalier kind of air about them. They were deadly. They were deadly with a pistol, and they were deadly on horses. So they painted themselves in this arena of these kind of rock stars of the era. And they had this underground force of people with them that was definitely helped them get down the road. But, you know, a lot of these guys were crazy. created. You know, they were part of situations and scenarios of the time that things happened in their lives that definitely changed the direction of which way they went or were going to go. So the first person I'm going to pop up here is, we're going to pop up. And, you know, here's the deal. Whether there's three people on here or 100 people, tonight, you want as many people as ever. But the truth of the matter is, I wanted to watch these videos again. I wanted to see, I haven't watched these basically since I shot them. And they intrigued me at the time, or I wouldn't have shot them. So the first one I'm going to show you is the James Farm. So we'll go to a guy that's probably the most famous of all these battles, even though he lasted way longer than the rest of them did as far as his criminal history, because at once there wasn't a criminal history because they would tell you it was war. But then there was a point when the war was over. Jesse James chose not to go down that path. He lived this lifestyle, and I want to go back and see this myself. So that's why I'm going to put this in. I've got three videos lined up. I've got the Quantrell's camp where they were on their way to Lawrence after the tragedy. We talked a little bit last night. If you were there, if you weren't there, I'll go back and go over it. But I'm going to show you, if you get a chance to go to Kearney, Missouri. Now, Kearney, Missouri, and this is all memory, is about, I believe, 30 miles north of Kansas City, heading towards Iowa. And it is the James Farm. And they have a museum there that's spectacular. And it is the farm. So it's not, you know, some, there is a building that is the museum that is stellar. But there's also the original James Farm where all this stuff started and where Jesse James was originally laid to rest at the location of the house. And the main reason was is that they put him outside his mother's room so she could watch out over him with a double-barrel shotgun to make sure that somebody didn't try to come dig him up. And then eventually he was moved to another location. And if you saw the special about Jesse James, they actually dug him up to make sure that that was him somewhere around like late 90s or somewhere in that area. I don't even remember at this point. But he's built buried now in the Kearney Cemetery, which is right off the main street, like in the main open area. They have his original headstone too, which was just chewed up because people kept stealing trinkets off of it. So I'm going to start this off with Jesse just because he's definitely the most popular and the most, you know, he is the number one guy when it comes to that era. When you think of bank robber, you think of outlaw, you think of Confederate soldier, he is the number one ranked guy. When you put him on here, you know, there's very few people that people remember even today. Jesse James is that guy. He Wyatt Earp, Doc Holliday, Jesse James is bigger than all of them. Geronimo. There's these characters that just pop out in history that will live forever, whether the history was accurate or the history was not. And here is Mr. James.
Breck, myths, legends, and lies. You wouldn't believe where we're at today. We are at the James Family Farm. Now, when you say James Family Farm, the first thing you've got to think about is James. Who would that be? Well, that would only be the most notorious outlaws ever. And that would be Jesse James and his brother Frank. Now, we're at the homestead of the original homestead of the James family. It's been in the family for over 150, 175 years, and is absolutely spectacular. And take a look real quick at this farmhouse.
Local and just heard about all the tornadoes
Jesse James was really getting to be a pain in the railroad's life. And so what they did was they sent Pinkerton out to this very cabin, and they got word that the two brothers were in this cabin. Now, in this very building, those Pinkerton came to this house with a bomb. They wrapped this bomb in cloth, lit it on fire, and threw it through this very window on that side of the house. Now they're doing some reconstruction now, as you see. That bomb was thrown in to the house. And so when that bomb came in, kicked that ball that was on fire into the fireplace, well, it exploded, killing the young son and also taking the arm of Esmeralda off. And later in life, it had to be amputated. Well, this, I mean, and they weren't even here at that time. So what's happened is now there's all this outcry from how evil the Pinkerton company was, killing an innocent boy and maiming her. And so she got free railroad service the rest of her life because they felt so bad on the errors and the mistakes they made. But this is fascinating that this is the very house, the very room. Now they're doing some renovation because of this age of this house of in 1822. So, you know, you're looking at a pretty old house right here. So it's fascinating to be out here and to really feel the history that you can coming to the James Farm. Look how beautiful this is. Now, this is the original grave site of Jesse James right here. And then it was moved later. But originally, she said she wanted to make sure that she kept a hold of this area so she could keep an eye on him. J-Trek, myths, legends, and lies. When you think of outlaws, who do you think of? Well, I know the guy that I think of first, and that's Jesse James. Proposition in the government after the war reconstruction slowly got back those places in legislature. And so there came a point where even the violence of Jesse James was at a point where they didn't really even want to support him anymore. The governor of Missouri, Crittenden, actually put a bounty on Jesse and Frank's head, even though at this time Frank had decided that, you know what, he really didn't want to live that lifestyle any longer. And he wanted to make a change, and Jesse couldn't. He was addicted to the lifestyle, he was addicted to the fame. His ego was so big at that time, he couldn't really do anything else. So he got another group of the Fords together to start another gang to do more bank robberies without Frank. And the governor Crittenden had actually talked with the Ford brothers and told them that he would pardon them if they killed Jesse James. There was a reward and they'd be pardoned. Well, so on that fateful day, Jesse did something he never did. He took his guns off, and guess what? Bob Ford decided that was the perfect opportunity and shot him in the head. You know, the amazing thing about those guns is the at that point you had to click the trigger back. So when Jesse James was on that chair, adjusting that picture, dusting that picture, whatever he was doing, which is kind of funny in itself. And he heard that click. He knew it was done. I mean, he had two seconds between the time that he was shot in the head and killed. The funny thing is they actually tried the Fords for murder. They sentenced him to hang, and then Crittenden come in and pardoned him. And that didn't set well. And so they actually toured around, and he actually toured and told people how he killed Jesse James. And, you know, it was really important that they put, even on his tombstone, killed by a coward. And, you know, one thing I will say about Jesse James, he was so violent, and there's no other way that you were going to get that guy. I mean, and, you know, the way that they lived their life, I mean, it was fitting that they lived by the sword and they died by the sword. You know, that's just the way it was. And, you know, the funny thing was, guess who else got assassinated? Yeah, right, Bob Ford did. So, you know, live by the sword, die by the sword. You know, Jesse James did have a fascinating life. I mean, he did become this Robin Hood type character to these people until he ran out of use for those political causes. And even John Newman eventually couldn't even justify his ruthless killing. And so, you know, he became a legend. Was he a myth? Absolutely. The real myth of what we think of Jesse James is this this whimsical character that robbed from the rich and gave to the poor. It's total crap. The reality of it was he was a ruthless, bloodthirsty killer. He was violent. You know, he was the youngest of the group, younger, who was very skilled, and so was his brother Frank, but they didn't run that gang because they weren't as ruthless as Jesse was. Jesse was a cold-blooded killer, but you know what? That is how it went down in history. And it's a fascinating story, it really, truly is. In search of Jesse James. I'm in the cemetery of Mount Olivet in Kearney, Missouri, at the gravesite of the infamous Jesse James. Jesse James, his original grave is here, but it was taken apart. People would chip away the tombstone so there was absolutely nothing left. So we saw what was left at it at the farmhouse in the museum, because people would steal his grave. But he's here with Zerelda. Original James Farm. Now, this building
Now, if you ever get a chance to go to Kearney, Missouri, don't miss going to the James Farm. I mean, it's really cool, because that is the building. You know, when you're looking at that, and then that, some of the pictures you saw, they have the museum there, and they have the original tombstone that is there that's chipped away. And it is fascinating that history, his guns, those boots. You know, the fascinating thing about it to me is, though, if you look at some of those artifacts that are there that are priceless, those things were millions of dollars. I mean, his stuff would be so valuable on the open market, it'd be unbelievable, because he is the quintessential outlaw of the Wild West. When you think of that, you think of the bank robbers, you think of all these guys, he is the guy that that comes to mind first. And then the funny thing about, you know, then we went to, this last summer, we went to Bob Ford's tombstone, which he's in, would be in the middle of the state by Warrensburg. And he is buried there now. And he had a hard time after that. He did some touring around telling people how he killed Jesse James. But you have to understand, there were a ton of people out there that loved Jesse James. They loved what he stood for. They loved that, you know, he was the Robin Hood and all this. And so he, Bob Ford, had opened a bar in Denver, Colorado, and a gentleman came in and with the double barrel shotgun that said, "Hi, Bob. Hey, Bob." And Bob turned around and he cut him in half with a double barrel shotgun. And it was all from the fact that they were retribution for the killing of Jesse James. And so that's how powerful this guy was. He had a guy go assassinate his guy, you know, because of the loyalty to that. And that's what you dealt with a lot that lasted for a hell of a lot of years that a lot of people don't want to look at or see. Just because the war was over, it didn't stop. And there was a division throughout for so long. It was unbelievable. It really was. And that lasted for a long, long time. And so that's the fascinating thing about that story. Now, that's pre-border wars. Now, he was with me the other night and we talked about Archie Clements. The amazing thing about Archie Clements was he basically gets the credit to some degree for training Jesse James. So you think about these guys and how ruthless they were. You know, Jesse James had nothing but admiration for Archie Clements, of how good a soldier he was. But in reality, I think that would be more like how brutal he was. And these guys learned how to, you know, do things that, you know, at the time in war was acceptable, even though at the time it was pretty unbelievable, the feats that they did. But this lifestyle that they lived and you can't get around the fact that these guys were the movie stars or the rock stars of their era. You know, people loved them. And they were willing to fight for him because there was so much of one side or the other coming to each other's farmhouse. Now, you saw the tombstone of his stepfather, who was a preacher. They came to the house, they beat him. And they say that changed the whole deal as far as, you know, Jesse James becoming Jesse James. This is where he got, you know, if you want to call it indoctrinated or whatever. I mean, you know, if you put yourself in their shoes to a certain degree and you have a group of people, whether it be North or South, come to your farm and beat your father or mother or wherever, whatever at the time, you know, that hatred and that vengeance was going to happen. And again, you're talking about some of the most brutal people on the face of the earth, which would be adult males between 15 and 20 in history, throughout history, have always been the most violent and brutal people in society. And so, you know, you look at the Arch Clemens, the dude died in early 20s, 20 or early 20s. And this is how they lived their lives. They were going to be the Jimi Hendrix again, the 27 Club to a certain degree. They were going to live hard and they were going to die fast. And most of them didn't make it. A few did. You know, Frank James, you know, he knew they were coming for him after Jesse was assassinated. And so this is where it bred all these people in the Midwest. It bred all these individuals. And like I said, there's a lot of people that are a lot better at knowing the ins and outs of all these battles and things like that as we fly over at 20,000 feet just to try to touch certain things that caused all the things that happen even today out here and the transition and the movement and the way the government was run and all those things came down to what was going on. But if you could have been around Kansas and Missouri on the border in that era, you know, you wouldn't even want to pop up. These people were roaming all throughout that area, and it wasn't just a few miles. It was way back. It was deep into both states. And if you got caught out, I mean, there's a pretty good chance you weren't going to make it back in. I mean, it was lawlessness to the unbelievable degree. And then it also brought in this group of people throughout the country that were just as ruthless, that wanted to either take advantage of it or just become a part of it. And so I will set this up a little bit. And so you have this conflict. You have one side that thinks the government is overwhelming. You have another side that thinks that, you know what, one side's more of a slavery at a point where, you know, are they going to allow Kansas to be a free state, or is it going to be a slave state? You know, and they're fighting to make sure that it's not a slave state because it's a territory at the time. And then you have a neutral state, which is Missouri, which is really not neutral from a 20,000 feet flyover. And so you have these conflicts, and you have both parties crossing the border, coming in from Kansas and going in from Missouri to Kansas, and they are waging war on each other. And they're going to these farms, and they're stealing, and they are hanging, and they are killing. And so, you know, I've said this before, the Youngers were more considered to be more of a northern group, but when they were accosted by northerners, then they turned on them and they became Confederates. So that happened more times than you probably would even imagine. So once these groups that really weren't representing a side, they were more representing freelance killers and stealing. And so you had that going on. And so you started building this powder keg that was getting to get ready to blow, and it did. And so when they're trying to control these sides and trying to control this, and you know, both sides were doing stuff that was unbelievable, and it caught up to both sides. And so that's where it started, right? I said yesterday a little bit about what kind of happened. So you have these bushwhackers, which are the more southern leaning, and they have this home base in Missouri where everybody knows them. So they have all these people willing to help them, bring them horses, bring them food, putting them up for the night. So they have all these people out there that are actually helping and aiding and abetting these groups out there to be able to survive and to do all this stuff. So there's a point where they get sick and tired of that. Jayhawkers. And so they decide that, you know, they're going to take all these people that are out there that are aiding and abetting all these, the women of these people, these Confederates, and they're going to put them in prison. And so they're going to go round them up, and they're going to decide that, hey, you know what, if we can keep all these other people from aiding and abetting these bushwhackers, then, you know, what we can do is be able to control and contain this. Well, they put them in jail in Kansas City, Missouri. The great story about the guy that owned the jail, which is bizarre in its own right. We won't get into that tonight, but it'll be left for another discussion. But anyway, the jail collapses. Now, when the jail collapses, people said, well, it was old. People said, well, they were trying to escape. People said, there's all these things. Then there's the conspiracy theories that just, you know, nothing any different than happens today. You know, no one really knows that ever has said that I've ever heard that this is exactly what happened. But anyway, the end result is that this building collapses. And when it does, it kills numerous members of these girls or these women that were in there. And a lot of these were direct descendants of and or sisters, mothers of these bushwhackers. And, you know, Bloody Bill Anderson, his daughter, his sister was in there, and she was killed, and another was maimed. And so these guys, who didn't need any reason to be any more violent than they already were, now they had a cause. And so they met at this farm down here at the Blackwater Rendezvous. And at the time, they didn't even know where they were going when they were told to meet down here. They didn't really know. And they had kind of a meeting that night, this night, down there by the river. And they discussed that it was an agreement that they were going to seek revenge for what had happened to them in Kansas City, and that they were going to go to Lawrence, Kansas, which was considered to be the more of the Mecca or the heart of the Jayhawkers. And they were going to, seek vengeance. And so at this close to this location. You know, we didn't have the exact location, but I know we're in the window or in the area where they were at. This is where this started. So this is where they, when they call Bleeding Kansas, this is the start of the journey of Quantrell and all these guys that you heard about in all the books, right? The Youngers, the Jameses, the Clements, the Pools, I mean, all these guys that in that window are unbelievably famous. And there's tons of them because there was a ton of these guys that were well known for their ability to fight. And so they take off and they're heading to Lawrence, Kansas that next day. And so I picked up, and what I wanted to do was go to the location they were in to begin with. And then what I wanted to do was end up in Lawrence and walk the best I could with the knowledge that I had of what happened that day, which was one of the biggest massacres in U.S. history. And it was unbelievably horrible. But it was what happened. This is the reason why it happened. You know, they didn't go there just because they wanted to decide to kill more people. They went there to seek vengeance for the fact that the people at that point believed that this was intentional. It wasn't just a building fell down. They believed that they intentionally undermined the building so it would collapse and kill these people. And in return, they decided they were going to go across. And this vengeance didn't end there either. This vengeance came back and forth. So I'm going to kick this video up, and I won't play all of it. We'll kick some of it in since we played some of it last night. But, man, it's a beautiful area. And you, even to this day, I mean, it's amazing to see what was that when it was there. It was cool just to be there. Now, a lot of people, when they think of Columbia, this isn't Columbia. Columbia, Missouri, which is where Missouri University, MU, Wild, our Cats, Tigers are at. This is not there. This is Columbus, which is a small town that is just on the other side of Lee's Summit, in between there and Warrensburg, which is on the would be on the east side of Kansas City. So this is where this is at, and when they were taken off. And this is the location that they started the march to Bleeding Kansas in Lawrence, Kansas.
You know, you get an opportunity every once in a while to go to a location that you just know was a very special location. Maybe not always for the right reasons was it special, but, you know, that doesn't really matter. The truth of the matter is I'm outside of Columbus, Missouri, which used to be the county seat in Missouri. And I'm at a location that was a starting place to probably one of the biggest massacres in U.S. history. And that was the beginning of the raid on Lawrence, Kansas. And they were going to be right over that hill. So if you look over there where the bend is and those trees, right along that creek over there, where you're going to find is a place where over 200 men gathered in this very location to perform probably one of the most unbelievable massacres in U.S. history. And you know, this was retaliation. The unrest in this area was unbelievable. They had burnt towns, and then another catastrophe happened.
And so,
guerrillas. And so at 5 a.m., he sent two scouts down to Lawrence to see what was going on, if it was clear to go ahead and come into town. So those scouts came back, and they told him that basically the town was clear. On the way in, Quantrell didn't know exactly how to get to this point. So on the way, what they did was they would grab guys from the area to try to see, figure out how to get to this point. Now, he would get these guides, and then after he was done with them, he would kill them. I mean, they came to Lawrence, Kansas with a vengeance. You know, Quantrell would have walked up to this door and he would have knocked on this door just like we're doing.
Hi, I'm Dennis Daly. This is the Robert Miller home. It was this, built, this house was built in, that part was built in 1858, this part in 1863. The same year that Quantrell marched right up in front of this house. They came in on what is basically the Oregon Trail. Which is never a trail, it's wherever it's dry. So we have some Oregon Trail back there, and he actually passed in front of the house.
Okay.
They came up the Oregon Trail, also known as the Franklin Road. Franklin is a little hamlet about 2 miles that direction, which was a pro-slavery hamlet. And at the time, 1863, Lawrence was 2 miles that direction. Downtown Lawrence, two or three blocks of downtown Lawrence.
Okay.
He rode in from up the Franklin Road, up the Oregon Trail. I've written a journal article about that. You can read it sometime if you like. They came up that trail, which passed directly in front of this house. They stopped here about 8:30 in the morning. One of the daughters, who was in her early 20s, Margaret, heard them, came to the door, visited with them. One of the men recognized her. Quantrell actually recognized her. She recognized him. And part of the story is that two or three weeks before Quantrell came to Lawrence for the raid, one of his men came here on a scouting trip, and he spent the night here and had a meal here. And so they all knew some of them knew of the Millers, of their hospitality. They fed and watered their horses, and after a short period of time, they rode on.
Mm-hmm.
George, who was the youngest son, who was like 18 at the time, after the raid was over, he rode into town, but some of Quantrell's men met him, intercepted him, chased him back down the Oregon Trail, and he rode past this house over on the other side of our property. We've got 5 acres in here, and into a cornfield. And Quantrell's men never went into a cornfield because they didn't know it was going to be in there.
Right.
So there were many people saved in Lawrence because they went into cornfields and were basically held safe.
Well, that's Jim Lane, wasn't Jim Lane?
Jim Lane was on
the same thing. He ran into a cornfield and they didn't chase him.
Jim Lane lived on the far west side of what Lawrence was then, which would be about Mississippi, Alabama Street.
Okay.
And when he heard that they were coming in, he went into the cornfield, saved himself. right. as a result of that.
So this house was saved because of the hospitality of the week. Is that what
there are several ways. There are several interpretations of that.
Right.
One is that this, if you've been to South Carolina, you've seen this house. Robert Miller came from South Carolina. He was a member of a group called the Associated Presbyterian Church. And when they settled in the 1700s in South Carolina, a whole group of them settled there. One of the principles of that particular church was that they could not hold slaves, which in the 1750s and 1780s and even early 1800s is not a problem. But by 1840, it was a serious problem. And Robert Miller was accosted in South Carolina, beat up by pro-slavery folks. And his son, one of his sons, came to Lawrence in 1854, Josiah Miller, who was a senator and a probate judge here in Lawrence, and wrote letters to his parents urging them to come to Lawrence. And I've written a journal article in the Journal of Kansas History on those letters, urging them to come. They hesitated, I think, partly because of their commitment to that religious group, partly because they had a huge farm holding in South Carolina. But ultimately, he sold his farm, and Mr. and Mrs. Robert Miller and Susanna Miller and several of their children moved to Illinois, spent a couple of years there, and then finally in 1858 came to Kansas City, by up the Mississippi to Kansas City, and then over here. Mm-hmm. That was in April of 1858, and by December of 1858 this house was built. Mm-hmm. It's a lovely old house.
So your history with this house, you knew what you were buying when you bought it. Were you connected with the house because of the history, or what's your history?
I was on the factory university.
Okay.
And we were looking for, we lived over on the other side of town in a very modern home, which is part of our taste. And one day in 1983, we drove by here, and there's a little bitty sign out in front of this set place that said for sale. And we whipped in and pulled up right here and went in to visit with Mrs. Eller. And about half an hour into that discussion, we discovered it wasn't only whether we would decide to go and live here, it's whether she decided we should live here.
Yeah.
Because they had some investment in the property and in the history. And I've been involved in that's not my field, but I was always interested in history. And when we came here, we renewed our interest in this history. And we've met members of the family. They've given us incredible photographs and documents associated with the Miller family.
Right.
It's amazing. So we have a lot of history that people come here like you, all the time. School children visit here five times a year. The most meaningful part for me is because this place was also a part of the Underground Railroad.
Right.
Is that black families will come and get out, and I will always go out and visit with them. And their experience with this place is completely different than my experience of this place, because their experience is heritage of slavery.
So black families would come here knowing their history.
Oh, yeah.
They're connected with this as well.
They hear there's some stuff at the visitor center. They hear that this is one of the few places that's documented is on the Underground Railroad. Slaves came up the same trail that Quantrell did.
Right.
The last time that happened, there was a family from Illinois, a father, a mother, and four children. He was in his 40s. He was on the faculty at the University of Illinois. And he was trying to explain to his children what this place was. And because the small smokehouse where slaves were kept when they came to this property is no longer here. Mm-hmm. he wanted to know where that, where was it? So he, it's right over there. And they, the whole family walked over there and stood there. And the dad tried to explain what visiting here meant to him. He got about halfway through that and just fell into tears, as did his wife. And I'm standing there trying to understand what that really meant. Mm-hmm. 419 years of slavery is what that meant. And it's playing, it's being played out today.
Right.
So I've had some incredibly powerful moments with black families. Some of the Raider families have also visited here from Kansas City. Mm-hmm. And that's always a fascinating thing, because the last one was a great granddaughter of a, either one great or two greats, I can't remember, of one of the Raiders. And I'm just telling the story. And I could see her wrestling with what ultimately turned out to be enormous personal guilt. Just huge personal guilt that she was associated with 200 men being slaughtered in this community in August of 1863. It's fascinating to watch unfold. You never know which direction all that stuff's going to go.
Now, if we look through here, what we're going to find out is we're going to see a hand-dug well right here.
That's the original hand-dug well from the facility. He loved that. Yes. I loved it too.
And they carried about Peggy carried.
Now here is Miller, who was.
Just real quick, right there, that is in the Lawrence Cemetery, and that is the monument for the people that were, excuse me, that were killed and buried. And that's a weird, not weird, but it's an interesting cemetery, because a lot of these players in that history. And what they, I found about that guy that I loved about, see, to me, that's history, is that he has this location where everybody that has a different story and a different feeling can come and be welcome. And he was just fascinated that he could be a part of the fact that all these different people could come in and have all these different experiences, and you're going to have different experiences. And that's what history is all about. I love the fact, and I have a whole deal on him that's a lot longer than that, because it was fascinating. This guy just let me in. He didn't know me. He just was, you know, he felt like that house was kind of part of his, you know, his destiny, that he was going to have that house and be able to share that experience with a bunch of different people. And that's why history is important, that it's there, so everybody can come and have that experience. Then you go to the cemetery, and then this is where the monument's at. And also another key player that was a Jayhawker that had a fascinating story.
Lived in that house down the way. One lived to 26, Carlisle, and there's Josiah, which was the son, and he lived about 50 years, died in Lawrence, Kansas, and then I'm sure the dad is over here as well. There's Mary and Irene. Agnes, and then here's more Millers over here. So this is the Miller plot right through here. Miller family. Now, one of the gentlemen that they were looking for when Quantrell rode into Lawrence was this gentleman right here. And his name was James H. Lane. Now, that's Junior. but seniors got to be here just as well. General James H. Lane, right there he is. So that was the guy that they, one of the guys that was on the list. Now he saved himself by running into the cornfield. And that's how a lot of people saved themselves when the rebels or the guerrillas from both sides were coming. They run into the cornfields. It's pretty incredible to see this. It really is. Kind of sombering. You know, we were talking about that, you know, the way they marked the memorial down there. This guy here did as much damage to his side, you know, to the other side as this guy did to his side. So it's kind of like funny how they did that. But you can tell we're in a pretty historical part of the. Quantrell left the Miller farm and headed towards Lawrence. He came to modern day 11th Street, which was at that time Quincy. Now at this time, the guerrillas decided the best way to assault Lawrence would be to split up into threes and go down the three main boulevards of Lawrence, which would be New Hampshire, Vermont, and Massachusetts. Now at this time also, the first casualty had occurred. Two members of the guerrilla party split off and went to a place known as Reverend Snyder's farm. He was out milking the cows, and that day they gunned him down in his front yard, and he died in his wife's arms. But that was the first casualty. But it was early, and there would be many, many more before this day was over. Now Quantrell, he would have led his men down the main drag, and that was Massachusetts. And what he encountered down here was a regiment of black soldiers that were basically brand new to the Corps. Now here's the funny thing about that. Some instances say that they were all killed, and some of the instances say that they all escaped. It's really funny how history, I mean, you would think that would be a pretty simple thing to figure out, but it definitely was not. So that's what's funny about history, is a lot of times you just don't know. I mean, there should be a record of that many recruits either escaping or being killed, but definitely there was not. So it's right on down here where he would have come down here. He would have taken his group down this main drag of Massachusetts, and he would get ready for one of the bloodiest encounters up to that period, considering this was mainly citizens. Now why would they have come to Lawrence and risked all this journey all the way over here to the city of Lawrence? Well, you know, it was a hotbed for people that would go across and also do the same type of activities in Missouri, and this is where a lot of them based out of, you know, coming to Jim Lane, which we saw his grave marker in the cemetery. But there was also a lot more money here. This was a pretty influential town. So if you were going to attack somewhere, this would have been a great place to do it, to be able to get funds to also further your cause. But he headed right down this street as we speak right here before he encountered his first resistance at all. And it really wasn't much of a resistance. It was new recruits that really didn't know what they were doing. And one side of this coin is that they all were killed. One side of the coin is they were all let go. So who knows at that point? So right here at 1001, right here, would have been the location that the group that Quantrell first encountered that would have been camped out there. Now, I would have thought, in all honesty, that it would have been pretty difficult, that they wouldn't have attacked and it wouldn't have killed them regardless. I find that, I mean, Union soldiers in dress, I would find that hard to believe that Quantrell, they've already killed the first guy who was a member of the Union. So why wouldn't they kill these guys? But it's hard to say. But it was right there, if you can imagine, Quantrell coming down here with all that regiment of army. Now, he had 400 guys in the group, so you can figure that, 125 to 140 per group, and the main one coming down this part of town would have been an incredible sight to see.
Now, it's an interesting story about Lane. Now, Lane was the counterpart to me, as far as I'm concerned. People could look at history a little different, but Lane was the guy. They were coming for Lane. Lane was known, if you look at that, there's the Osceola raid that he was a part of. And so they basically did the same thing in a certain, maybe not to degree, because they didn't have just the opportunity. But man, it wasn't like this side was getting after it and that side didn't. I mean, it was brutal and it was bloody and they really didn't care. So Lane runs into the cornfield and they wouldn't go into cornfields. Isn't that funny? That was the rule, man. You did not go in the cornfields because you didn't know what was going to happen. You didn't know if it was an ambush. So, so somewhere down the road, they got ambushed that way. And so from there on out, man, if you wanted to get away, the place to get away was get in the cornfield. So it's when I first learned of the Lawrence Massacre, I couldn't believe that, that could have happened, so I did the more research and I'm not, I'm as accurate as I can be, but the reality of it is I'm not, who knows how accurate it is. But you walk down those streets and it's like any other modern street that's, known for their basketball, KU, Jayhawkers. And most people don't realize, that you see the bird and you think, well, it's a bird, right? And the Jayhawkers are the Jayhawkers. They're the people, right? They're the counterparts to the Bushwhackers, right? So you got the Bushwhackers and the Jayhawkers, or the Redlegs, right? And so that's part of the stuff that still lives on today, which I find amazing. Now imagine that, and they don't seem to have an exact count. Every time you read a history book, also there'll be a different account of how many people, but there was a bunch. There was 150 plus people that were killed. They killed pretty much everybody, with exception for some reason they did not kill women. That was not part of the deal. Now a lot of people don't realize that they knew Quantrell. Quantrell was a school teacher there, and Quantrell's story is fascinating. It's fascinating how this guy ended up being the leader of this ruthless group of men that were just unbelievable. Is fascinating because, one side of it doesn't seem like it should even be possible that he should even rise to those ranks from his roots as a school teacher. The guy was a school teacher. And not that there's not some, I'm married to a school teacher, so I understand how vicious they can be at times, unprovoked or provoked. I'm going to throw that in there. But the reality of it is that's what he was. So when you look at all the pieces and the players in this war, right, you look at them, and it's fascinating. It really is. What got them going? What got them started? Where did the Jesse James of the world come from? Lane was no different, man. He was brutal. And these guys were. And so that was the hotbed where they were staying. And I won't get too much more into the other part of it. That was part one. And it was cool looking back there. Lawrence is a cool town. Lawrence was a place as a kid, or say even a young adult, it was a college town. So, I was a part of different groups that had bands. So we'd go there to see bands. And it was really always that cool college town, that kind of hip town. But going back there on this other side of it, as the history goes, very fascinating history. And a lot of what you'll see is a lot of the houses that are still standing. One of the things that are extremely cool about the Midwest, whether you're in Lexington or you're in Liberty or you're in St. Joseph, a lot of these structures that meant such in Independence, right? They're still standing. These same buildings that were there during the times are still there. So when you go up there, just like the gentleman, the Miller House, How fascinating is that, that that house is originally, and he told me what they had problems with that house, and they were having to do some brickwork, and the amount of money it cost was like 20 times more than it would have been if you were going to brick it, because they had to take it back and put it back historically like it was if they wanted to continue to hold the history label on it. And man, it was ridiculous. But you know, you could tell that that house meant, you know, meant the world to him. And not everybody, you know, is a, loves history like that, to be able to preserve it in that large of a manner and still embrace it like he did. He loved that hand dug well. I mean, that's still, that's the original hand dug well. And I mean, you think about that, and it is pretty fascinating to look at that. And so we're going to kick in number two. Now I will tell you a story. I had plantar fasciitis when we were walking, and I thought that was going to kill me. And we walked all over. I was with my brother-in-law, Darren, who is a big history nut as well. And thank God, because that's, he was hauling me around all these locations, but hopefully he had fun in the mix. And, but man, it was a tough day. It was a hard, hard day. So let's pop into the second part of it. And again, we're dealing with the North and the South. We're dealing with the border wars. We're dealing with Quantrell and Lane and the cast of characters. So that is the content for all you that aren't sure if you need to be here. I'd rather have three people that want to be here than people that are like, I don't want to know about this because this is whatever it is. Boom.
White flag of. Now Quantrell came down Massachusetts, heading north, and he got to the Eldridge House. Now this isn't the original building, but it is the original location. Now Quantrell believed at this point he was in for a battle because this was the head of the militia. And so they surrounded this building here, believing that it was going to be an unbelievable battle. But to their surprise, it wasn't at all. That the commander at this location basically raised a window and gave him a white flag of surrender. And so what they thought was going to be a battle was not. Now, the armory was located across the street. So there was the armory here. Now, the gentleman that had the key was shot dead, so they never ever even got the armory unlocked. Now, one of the funny things about it also is that there was a rule in this town that you couldn't have a gun. So how crazy is that? So all of the guns were locked up in the building that would have been the armory. So Quantrell leaves here looking for Lane, because Lane was the prize, because he had been causing havoc in Missouri for a long, long time. But he had already escaped into a cornfield. Now, how I understand it is, one thing Quantrell's men would not do was follow you into the cornfield. So they got Quantrell back here to tell him that, you know, there was a pharmacy in the basement of this building and that there were flares gonna blow up. So he did take the prisoners. Now they marched all of the residents of this hotel down to the bottom floors and robbed them. And then eventually the building did catch fire and burn to the ground. So what Quantrell believed was going to be one of the biggest fights was no fight at all. So he had made it to downtown Lawrence basically unscathed, which was kind of unbelievable when he figured that this was going to be an unreal battle at this point, was none at all, which is pretty amazing when you think about it. One of the major things to think about when Quantrell rode down Massachusetts Avenue is that they pretty much were shooting anybody that resisted at all. The word basically came out that if you were old enough to hold a gun, then to shoot you as far as the males. Now, they spared all the females. So when you look down this road, you would have saw bodies along these sidewalks because they were shooting anybody that was out and about. So one of the things to remember is that it was a turmoil, and they would have heard them coming at the Eldridge house when they came down here, which might have been one of the reasons that they surrendered so easily, was because they had already, you know, been on a murder spree up and down this road. So that might have been one of the main reasons that they basically, when they got to this location where they thought they were going to have a problem, they probably would be able to see out of these windows too the amount of guerrillas that were in the area, which they say was up to as high as 400. So that might have been one of the reasons that they did not even try to put up a fight at this location. Now, the people in the hotel surrendered. And so part of the surrender was that they would be guaranteed their safety. So Quantrell decided to take them down to the City Hotel, which is down at 6th and Massachusetts. Now, the thing to remember about Quantrell is he spent time here. He was a teacher here. So he knew a lot of the people, and he knew the individual that owned the City Hotel. So while this hotel was on fire, they then evacuated all the people out of that building, and they took them to the City Hotel. You know, so they brought the people to this location. Nathan Stone was the guy.
Now, I'm going to stop that just for 1 second, because when I did the audio clip, you hear a voice on this audio clip, and that was a place where stuff went down, which you'll find out. And this wasn't a ghost hunt. It wasn't supposed to be a ghost hunt. But every once in a while, when you do this, you hear things that, you know, are out there. And this is not the first time it's ever happened. But, you know, everybody thinks that, you know, this stuff comes up when it's dark and it's scary. But it just goes to show you, when you have sensitive equipment, you know, you'll pick stuff up, and it's absolutely unbelievable. And again, that wasn't supposed to be some type of scary ghost thing. But you know, is it history locked away? Was there some type of deal? And, you know, who knows? But you know that it's not a voice that you heard. You're standing in the street. And so you wonder if all that carnage, did it bring things that, you know, and again, it's the day, right? This is not some creepy type of ghost show. It's you pick up things sometimes that, man, you can't explain on that stuff. And you hear it and you're like, what did they just say? And you're like, well, man, a lot of stuff went down, and who knows? And I mean, I'm open-minded to it, but again, it's not a ghost show. It wasn't intended to be that, but you've definitely heard voices on that, man, they weren't there. Hell, it was just standing on the corner.
Now, remember the history with Quantrell. He was from this area where he taught school. So this was a friend of his. So basically he told his raiders that this place was off limits. But there was one drunken gorilla that didn't believe that. It was Larkin Skaggs. And Larkin Skaggs had stolen a ring from one of the daughters of Stone. And Quantrell found out, and he was livid. So he made him take it back. Well, that didn't sit too well with Skaggs. So after Quantrell had left, a drunken Larkin Skaggs came back to this location, and he then killed Stone. He was so drunk that the townspeople came and they got him and they dismembered him right here in the street. And so he was one of the very few people that got killed in this raid on the gorilla side. And one of the problems that they had was all these gorillas came extremely intoxicated and they become unruly. And so that's really what happened, is once they took this town over because of their drunkenness was why there was a real situation. So on this very location right here was where Larkin Skaggs was eliminated, as well as Stone. You know, at the corner here, you see the riverfront now on down below. You know, there was a ferry that would come across that river, the Kansas River. And Quantrell sent 15 men across over there to keep people, you know, the Union who were over there, that were firing over this direction, kept them from coming across the ferry. So he seized the ferry, basically. You know, once Quantrell believed that he had control of the city of Lawrence, he sent a large party over to 745 Vermont Street, because on this corner was the Johnson Hotel. And the Johnson Hotel was infamous because this was the headquarters of the Red Legs. And the Red Legs were a violent group of border ruffians that had really caused severe damage to the state of Missouri along the border. So his goal was to try to capture this location and burn it to the ground. We'd be right now on the west side of the square. So if you'll see this ravine down here and you'll look along here, what you're gonna see is a ravine. Now, when the raid was going on, the townspeople ran down to this ravine, and the raiders were very hesitant to come down in here. So they actually let them be. So if you were able to get down here into this location, then you might be safe. I mean, can you just imagine what this would have been like with all the bloodshed going on and coming down this direction, and the people fleeing for their lives down into this ravine? And it would have been a different deal now, wouldn't it, down in here? You know, next Quantrell rode across what used to be a bridge down here up to this house right here, which would have been 516 6th Street. And what you would have found right there was the mayor's house. Now, the mayor knew that they were coming, and him and his aide got in the well. Now, there was only one problem, though. Quantrell caught that house on fire, and they didn't leave until the house completely burned. But the mayor and his aide died in that well. Now, the sad part about that is not only did they die, another person came to look for him, got down in there to try to find him. The rope broke. They went down in there, and they also suffocated in the same well. So three men died right across that street that probably Quantrell didn't even realize that he killed. So it's just amazing the amount of death and destruction in this town. And you look up these tree-lined streets, and you just see how beautiful these houses are. But on that fateful day, a lot of those houses got caught on fire. Look at that fence. That's pretty cool. That's pretty old too. I didn't think it was until I saw that iron on the top. That iron on the top's ancient. You know, as you look around here, the first thing you start to notice is, you know, how beautiful these older homes are. And then you stumble across this marker, you know, let me kind of get an idea as you look down the streets. And then you get an idea and you look at this marker that's kind of precariously just set right here. It says that Griswold, Baker, and Thorpe and Trask were shot August 21st, 1863 on this very location. The word was that they went to the house and they told them to come out and they wouldn't hurt them, and they surrendered. And then I guess they decided that they weren't walking fast enough, and they decided, well, that one way to get rid of them, to make them walk faster, is just to kill them, I guess. So they shot them right on that location. Can you imagine all the stuff that was going on as this massacre was happening, and all the chaos that had been going on, and the fact that, you know, there were 400 riders up and down these streets, you know, they're calling people out of their homes, and it would have been an incredible sight to see, and one that the people of Lawrence would, some say, never forget. Now look at these beautiful homes here in these locations now. Through here. This beautiful house here. Look at these beautiful homes all the way down this boulevard. Now, one thing Darren was showing me is these are the original sidewalks. This is a slab. This has not been laid or poured. It's been laid, but not poured. So these sidewalks have been here, you know, since way back. And it's kind of intriguing that these old neighborhoods like this still hold. And they've done such a beautiful job of restoring most of these buildings. I mean, look at how beautiful this one is here. That's just unbelievable. And the commitment it takes and the money that it takes to do this is unbelievable. It's such a peaceful day today, but it sure wasn't a peaceful day on August 21st. Look at this spectacular house that is still standing from the time of the raid. This is the Hoyt House. This was a boarding house back in those days. Now, when Quantrill dispatched his guerrillas out to go find Lane, they passed this very location. And the reason that this house didn't get destroyed was that the keeper at that point said that an old widowed woman owned this location, and therefore they spared this house. Look at this thing. Can you believe what this house has seen? How incredible this place is. Look at this beautiful house. This house is unreal. And can you imagine, you know, these gorillas coming down this street? Because, you know, look how cool this house would even look then. You know, because look how neat it did. It would have looked actually probably a little neater because it would have been newer. But look how beautiful it looks now even. You know, all these years later. But because the gentleman inside lied and said a widowed woman owned it, that was one lie worth telling. You know, today you see the old postman walking down here on this tree-laden road and how beautiful it is. But if you can imagine on August 21st, and if you can imagine, you know, less trees, and you would have probably been able to see downtown Lawrence, and you probably would have been able to see the smoke. And I mean, you would have heard guns going off nonstop. And it would have been a whole different world back then. And you would have been pretty fearful of your life just to see if you were going to survive this. But I mean, the whole thing would have been unreal from the time that they rolled in the AM to the time that they finally in the PM rolled out of here. You know, we're on the corner of Mississippi and 8th. And this was the target location of a guy named James Lane. Now, James Lane was who they were really after. James Lane had spent a life, you know, planning and plotting and sending troops and people to Missouri to cause just the kind of same havoc that was happening here in Lawrence that day. So he was a big target. And his house was right in this vicinity on 8th and Mississippi. And on down was a cornfield. And the amazing thing about the guerrillas is that we find out they were very hesitant to either go into ditches or go into cornfields. And so he made his escape. Now we saw his tombstone, so we know that he made it because he lasted it out, and he lived a longer life considering the life that he lived. But look at these beautiful locations, these beautiful homes. I mean, these tree-lined. You know, back then this would have been fairly barren, and you probably would have definitely been able to see the smoke billowing. He knew stuff was going down. The guy knew that, you know, if he wanted to make it out of here, he better run. You know, here's a funny story that Darren was telling me about the Lane house. So he hides in the cornfield, she stays, because the guerrillas did not touch the women. And so here's something that's just incredible, and I don't really get it completely, but the guerrillas knew that they had to burn the house down. That was kind of like something they knew they had to do, and they were going to do it. But they helped her unload the goods out of the house before they burn it down. So there's a lot of weird kind of chivalry that you kind of don't get. And, you know, maybe it really comes down to, you know, the reality of it was they understood they were both you know, in reality, fighting for their own cause, and that they might be at the other end of that at one time in their life is the only thing I can figure. Now, the crazy thing that happened in this Lawrence massacre was that the women started to figure out that they weren't going to be more than harassed, and they turned the tables on the guerrillas. They started harassing the guerrillas and really pushing them. And it was probably incredible. And they're probably the ones that actually helped get rid of Quantrell and his men faster, because they had the courage to stand up to these guys. But then again, they also realized that they weren't in danger. You know, so it's pretty incredible to think that, you know, a lot of these women in mourning whose husbands and children have been killed, you know, turned the table on these people. Sure doesn't look like the site of a massacre here as we walk through these streets of Lawrence, Kansas, does it? Some of the most beautiful homes that I have come across. You know, here's a house here that belonged to the Bell family. And the husband went off to try to fight these guerrillas. And they left Mary Bell alone in this house with her six children. And the guerrillas tried to catch fire to this seven times with no luck. She and her children were able to put it out. Isn't that incredible that this house still stands because of the work that in saving this house? Now, the sad part of this story is he was found and killed. But she was able to save this house, the George and Annie Bell house, founded in 1863, which is pretty incredible. Look at this place. You know, even though it doesn't fit the size of a lot of the other ones that we've come across, there's something really special about that one. Maybe the determination of the woman that lived there to save it for her and her family. And you know how difficult that would have been, being up against these guys. I mean, these were tough guys, the toughest around. And the fact that she was able to save this house so it still stands today is incredible to me. The amount of courage that she showed to make sure that this house stood so me and you can look at it all these years later. You know, what is that, 160 years old, something like that? I don't think my house is going to stand that long, but look at that. That's incredible. What an incredible journey we have had walking these side streets of Kansas. You know, when Quantrell finally left that day, I'll tell you what, Missouri and Kansas would never be the same. You know, all those people dead, Order 11 after that. Unreal. I mean, it was really unreal. And it heightened the bloodbath of that time. And then there was also a point where they also said that anybody that was a guerrilla was a common thief and that they should be executed at the spot. So how incredible is this story of how this changed all these people's lives? Not, you know, I mean, husbands lost, fatherless children. You know, it's incredible how devastating the entire war was. And you know, slavery was this much of that. It was so much more. You could not be on a side regardless if you liked it or not, because you were getting berated by one side or the other. So you had to make a choice, whether it be a good choice or a bad choice, that you're going to have to side up with somebody regardless of what the theory was and what, regardless if you thought that was what you wanted to be. So, you know, we're going to leave this day in Lawrence, Kansas on this beautiful July day, thinking in the August 21st, how unreal the violence and the bloodshed was in this town. And it changed history forever. Thanks for coming along. If you'd like to donate to Patreon, you like...
Boom. Hey, Steve Taylor's on here. Steve Taylor is an old friend from Independence, Missouri. One of the most knowledgeable people that I know of that knows this stuff. He's the guy that knows the ins and outs, and he knows he's the ground, boots on the ground guy when I'm the 20,000 foot across guy. And it's a pleasure that you see people that still look at history and believe how important history is. And I'm pretty sure the nine people that are still on here, even though, you know, I didn't know what I'd get when it came down to the subject matter that I wanted to discuss, because I find it fascinating. Regardless, history is something that has to be saved. It needs to be saved. It needs to be respected, you know, and realize that you have to look at history with a common sense, balanced view, that, you know, people did what they had to do to survive. And, you know, the statement I made at the end, I believe very dearly in or deeply in, is that you had to side up with one side or the other, or you were going to get it. I mean, you had to have that protection. You had to be on one side or the other. You couldn't just be neutral. There was no neutral. And that was important. And, you know, I watch a lot of Steve does a lot of like in-depth battles and things like that. And, you know, I often wonder, you know, when you're going up Blue Cut or you're going up, you know, these places that I grew up at, right? I grew up in these areas. And, what a different time that would have been, going down these roads that you don't even know all this history. It's just like here when you drive past an ancient ruin site that's 20 yards off the road that you passed 1,000 times and didn't even know that the deep history was there. You just didn't know. And it's the same thing there when you get guys like Steve that go in depth and try to find these battle sites. And, you know, I was looking at a video of his today, as a matter of fact. And it's just intriguing to me that the action that went on in this was such a prevalent part of our history. And, you know, I love Lexington. Lexington's one of my favorite places ever. And, you know, the little arch, and we, you know, the funny thing was, and I've made this comment before, was you get a guy like Little Arch who is the Anderson's demon, Anderson's devil, and people are still intrigued by that. You know, that video is at 45,000 or something like that for a guy that most people have never even heard of. And these were people that existed, and they did their time on this earth, and they did what they felt was right, regardless of what the rest of the world thought. And they fought their cause, and some of them lost their lives in that cause. And it was just a fascinating place. I go up there and you think about it. You can't help but go to Kansas, and you can't help but go to St. Joe or to Lexington or Independence or any of these towns that have all this flavored history, you know. And then the most beautiful thing for me is that I can walk these things out to Phoenix, Arizona, and you can find Dave Poole's headstone, if you know who Dave Poole is, who came out here, and all these different guys that came out here to get away, right, to escape that world after it was. But, you know, if you survive that thing, my gosh, you know, they talk about the trauma of the different wars. You know, we never talked about that, you know, pre Iraq, you know, it was, but you knew it was there. I mean, you knew all that kind of mental, the mental issues you would have with what you saw, whether it be World War One or Two or Korea or any of the Vietnam, doesn't matter, right? You know, the brutality of life in the world would have a traumatic experience on everybody. And, you know, it would change you. It would be pretty hard to one day be fighting for your life and doing things that might be a little, you know, a little crazy, because you've been indoctrinated into this way of this lifestyle of brutality. And then one day say, oh, we're done, you know, okay, put your guns up, you know, put your gun, we're done, we've had enough. And it would be, just think about how hard. James couldn't do it. Jesse James couldn't do it. You know, he couldn't stop, you know, he was indoctrinated into a lifestyle, and, you know, who knows. And there, I believe with Jesse, there was a lot more to that. He was the rock star. Steve, I mean, you don't realize that a lot of guys that do this stuff don't realize that there's people out there that really do care about this history. And, you know, if somebody doesn't do it, and it's not going to be for reviews and things like that, because, you know, those videos that I had, they actually performed pretty well, but considerably, you know, not very well, because there's certain parts of history that people are afraid of. And I'm not afraid of it. And I'm not afraid of standing and looking at it. I'm not afraid to look at subjects that are, you know, sometimes to some people, you know, out of bounds. And there's no out of bounds subjects. You know, the only way that you don't repeat history is to know what the history is, accept the history for what it is, and then move on down the road and move on past it. And I think it's neat that we keep up on that, because that's these people lived their life. They were real people. And you look at it today, and it's really a fascinating thing to get to do these. And you're going to see me come on and do a lot more of these, of the stories that are out there, in the different parts of, whether it be Independence or whether I do Southwest stuff or Chaco Canyon or any of that stuff. I mean, there's fascinating stories throughout the West. And I just love that transition of those people that were going west. So you look at these blocks of time and you look at these battles, and then you see this transition of these people moving west, and then you see the technologies moving. And again, you know me, there's nothing cooler than just standing in a location that you know somebody in some period of time stood, whether that be Quantrell or whether that be Geronimo or whether that be, you know, any of the characters in history. The Glanton, standing on the rock where Glanton stood, one of the most vicious men that, you know, I mean, Little Arch would have fit in perfect out here if he would have made it. I mean, he would have been perfect for this, for the West. He would have been a hand in glove. You know, these guys that become extremely good at what they did, and what they did was they killed. And it's just a fascinating when you walk these streets to know that this history preceded you. And I want to thank everybody, because I knew going in I wanted to do this last time I went live, but I didn't want to throw people into subject matter that maybe they were, you know, cautious about or whatever. You know, I want you to know what you're going to see, because I don't even know sometimes when I go on, I got 20 different videos lined up, and that was one of them I wanted to go to, because it was really cool to me. I remember that valley in Columbus, and that is a gorgeous place. You know, the first thing I think about is metal detectors, because a lot of those locations you would think that there would be remnants. And, you know, I don't collect any of that stuff, but I always wonder, you know, I always wonder what's out there. And it's incredible to see that and to see that just the amount of strength it would have taken to survive back then, whether you were a man, a woman, or a child, doesn't matter. You would have had to been tough, man. The tough people would survive and the weak would perish. And there's no doubt about that. And on that fateful day, you know, but that's not all of it, man. Remember that they were coming from the other side over. Remember that this was a two-way street. This was not a one-way street. They went for particular people that were just doing the exact same thing. And then remember that, you know, a product of Lawrence, Kansas was Quantrell himself, right? And then they question all these stories that, you know, he had a great story about his brother being him and his brother, because he came out with his brother and they were doing some teamster work. And there's a story about his brother and the, you know, this tragedy that he had with the other side, right? That they say may not even be true, that he just had to create that story. But Quantrell's a fascinating guy, man. How he ended up where he ended up is pretty fascinating. You know, it's a pretty fascinating story and one that, you know, I'd like to know more. You know, if I ever get the time or the energy, I would like to do an entire story only on the horses of the bushwhackers. I would like to do a story just on that, because of their ability and the skill and the fact that they were in that window of the Comanche, which puts them on an elite character. These are elite horsemen, and how much those horses made a difference in what they did and how well they did it. You know, we know that Quantrell, probably his lack of his horse probably might have cost him his life, because he was going to surrender. And whether they would have been hung or not, who knows? But because of the fact that I was, you know, what I read was that because he didn't have his regular horse, the horse didn't do what he expected it to do. And that's what left him behind where he got shot. And that some say that if he would have had his original horse. But people don't look at things like that and realize that there was so much more. But, you know, no one can deny the fact that the Bushwhackers, they were this elite group of people that were, you know, they were cavalier. They dressed the part. They lived this, you know, this lifestyle that was a little more maybe live to ride and ride to live is the only thing I can say, man. They lived for their time. And it's credible that even a guy like Little Arch that most people have never heard of, you know, the guys, you Google him and he pops up. So these guys, even though they didn't live long lives, man, they made impacts a hell of a lot bigger than I'm ever going to make. So, you know, I appreciate you guys hanging out with me. We're not done doing this stuff. I'll pull archives out. You know, we talked a little bit, one of the stories that I want to do, is on the Arabia, the steamship that got found in the cornfield, the Greg Holly story. I went to school with Greg, and that's a great story. And you know, talk about a heritage that a guy left. That's a great story too, that just ties into all this stuff. So one day what I'll end up trying to do is get back on the road and take this Santa Fe trail out and follow the tracks and the trails of all the people that came through. But thank goodness for that gentleman that owned that house in Lawrence that was so kind to be able to open up and tell me his stories. You know, I found it fascinating. I really did. And whether we do a story on the Vail Mansion or whatever, some of the stuff like that, it's been a fun ride. And like I said, I love doing this. And whether one person watches it or 2,000, I don't care, you know. But I find it so neat. And maybe I'll try to get Steve on here, and we'll do a show with Steve. I can pop Steve on here with me, see if he's interested. Get a hold of me after this, Steve, if you would, and you might be interested in coming on and discussing a little bit of this history. That would be awesome. I'm going to get out of here tonight. I think we've lasted long enough tonight. Rock the Crystals, it always takes care of me, and I appreciate you guys very much. Don Barry's got some goodies that he sent to me that we will be giving away on Tuesday. Man, I might be on tomorrow. I may not, but stay in touch, pop it on, just like tonight. Last night, I wanted to see these videos again. I haven't seen them since I shot them. And it was like I wanted to get back in that. And again, there's so many cool things to see. And again, thanks to everybody. And Steve is on Facebook. And if you like this kind of history, you know, I can't tell you that he'll accept you into, because he's, you know, it's not a pace that, but he does tours and stuff like that. He still keeps people alive in the city of Independence, Missouri, in the outskirts. You might want to befriend him and tell him you came from this channel, then he'll know. And if you like that kind of stuff, he does cool videos on locations, on specific battles and things like that, if you're into that. So, again, I want to thank everybody, and you know, I might see you tomorrow, and I might not. Thanks for hanging with me, man, because we did three videos tonight, and that was super cool, and I'm glad I had an opportunity to go back and relive that myself. That was a cool day, and I want to thank my brother-in-law, Darren Key, out of Warrensburg, Missouri, the Berg, the home of the Biting Mule CMSU. That special that he took me for those rides. Every time I go back, we make a run and we go somewhere, and we had an awesome time every time we do it. And I appreciate him and appreciate you guys. I'm going to call it a day. You guys have a great day, and let's kick this thing out. And I appreciate each and every one of you. Please like, please subscribe. I'm on Instagram again now. I'm back on Instagram. I was off of it, but yeah, please give me a like, give me a thumbs up. That would be awesome. Adios.